Hello everyone. How are you today? Feeling good? Yeah? How was the pizza just now? Did you have had any pizza? Good? Yeah? All right. So my name is Roland Schuit and I'm from the Netherlands and I'm doing all kinds of things with .NET. Basically, I'm just doing what I love to do. So that's a dream job. And I'm also a Microsoft MVP. So and today I want to talk about ASP.NET Core SignalR and how that works. So I have a plan for this session. The plan is first we're going to what is a real-time web application, because that's the kind of application you can create with SignalR. Then we go into low-level protocols to establish that, right? SignalR uses several of these, and it's good to know to have a basic understanding of these lower-level protocols before we go actually into SignalR. Then we go into SignalR itself, and I show you a demo app, and then some notes about scaling a SignalR app out. So we actually have four parts in this talk. Does it sound good? Right, so part one, what is a real-time web application? Well, let me show you one. So we in the Netherlands, we have a site called vakantieveilingen.nl. And it's, so vakantieveilingen, the translation of that is holiday auctions. Holiday auctions. And the funny thing is, so they're called holiday auctions and they offer a skating match, right? I don't know. But the point is, you can see there's an auction going on and you can see that there's a live bidding going on this match, skating match. And every time an auction is done, a new one starts up and people start bidding again. Well, just not now, but normally. Let's see if we have any more. Oh, this is a guy called Sinterklaas. So we don't have Santa Claus, but we have Sinterklaas, and he comes at December the 5th. I don't know why, but so this is 17 euros now, and people are bidding on that. And of course, there's nothing real time going on now, because I'm showing it now, and I want it to go up. Come on. But you get the picture. So without doing any refresh, on the page, I get the actual information. And it seems like there is a connection between the server and the client instead of between the client and the server. And that's actually what's going on. All right. So the applications for this are you can have email clients, for example, if you use Gmail or Outlook for the web. When you look at your screen and you're logged in into the email client, when a new email comes in, you actually see the email coming in, right? You don't have to refresh the page or whatever. So the server is actually signaling the browser that there's a new email. Also social media, when new messages come in, web documents like Google Docs, right? Where somebody can edit the document and another person can see the editing while it happens. Auctions, like I said, gaming is an application, and stock quotes. These are just examples of what you can do with real-time web applications. So the basic thing is we have normally, in normal situations, we have a browser on the left side and a server on the right side. And there's a request going out to the browser, to the server, and the server responds. But now we have a server-to-client connection. So now the browser doesn't initiate the request somehow, but somehow the server initiates a request to the browser, the other way around. And that is what makes the real-time part of real-time web applications possible. And that is because there is an event happening on the server, because somebody else that also is using a browser does a bid on the skating match. And then I'm watching that auction and I see real time the change coming in. That was part one, so that was easy, right? So part one was easy peasy. We immediately go to part two, low-level protocols. So there are several ways to do that, to establish this behavior of the server sending the client an update. And long polling is really the poor man's version for doing that. So with long polling, we don't have any special support in the browser or in the server. We just use regular HTTP requests. And the browser opens up a request to the server, and the server doesn't immediately respond. It just keeps the request open. And when an event happens at the server for me, for that browser, then it will send a response. And if not, we get a timeout, right? So there are two situations. Either the request is being responded to between now and maybe 10 seconds or 20 seconds or whatever, or a timeout occurs. And when that timeout occurs, the browser is very dumb and it says, okay, the timeout has occurred. I'm just opening a new request and I'm going to wait again. And that happens time and time again. So this is not very efficient, of course, not efficient for server load, because many requests will come in, because this is only one browser, but we're talking thousands of browsers maybe, or maybe even more. So the server cannot handle probably that kind of requests, that many requests. So, of course, it's not very efficient for the browser as well, opening all these requests. So, the next iteration to solve this problem is called server-side events. And with server-side events is actually a standard. It's a standard. It's an approved standard, and it's still HTTP. But we now actually have a connection between the server and the browser. So the browser can do HTTP calls using server send events and actually send messages only when there is a message, right? So not the polling mechanism anymore. Whenever there's something to be done, the message is sent. So way less overhead. And to do that, we have an event source object available in JavaScript. So there's no need to install any JavaScript library or something. You just have event source available. It's just part of the ECMAScript standard. And of course, the server has to have some parts too. We don't really have a solution for that in ASP.NET Core, not like SignalR. But you can do it in ASP.NET Core. I actually have a demo. I don't have the time to show you all these demos. But if you're interested, it's on my GitHub. And you can see how that works. And server-side events, they're just simple HTTP. It will automatically reconnect. So when the connection disengages for some reason, it will automatically create a new connection. There's no support for very old browsers. Well, server-side events has been around for quite a time now, but there are still some browsers out there that don't support it. So, if a browser doesn't support it, you don't have an event source object, so you can easily test that. Easily polyfilled. So, if the browser doesn't support it, you can install a polyfill for that. There's a maximum HTTP connection issue. It's actually the same issue we had with long polling. There can only be so many connections open at the same time. And we have the same problem here because the server will open up many connections to all these browsers. And there's a limit to that. Mostly, most of the time, it's around 50 connections. It only supports text messages, and there's only a one-way connection possible. So you cannot send anything between browser and client. You just need to use regular HTTP calls for that. Now we go to the latest iteration, and it's called WebSockets. With WebSockets, we have a TCP socket. So actually, with HTTP, we also have a TCP socket, of course. HTTP is just a protocol that you run over in the TCP port. And the way WebSockets work is that initially, the client does a request to the server, and it asks the server to update this TCP socket that is used for this request, to upgrade that TCP socket to a WebSocket. And when the server agrees to that, from that point in time onwards, we don't use the HTTP protocol anymore to talk through that TCP socket, but the WebSocket protocol. That's an entirely different protocol. And instead of HTTP or HTTPS, we have WS or WSS as a prefix. So this WebSockets tunnel that you create between the browser and the server is a two-way tunnel. So you can send messages from server to client, server to browser, but also from browser to server. And it's actually more efficient than HTTP because especially when you have multiple things going on, you want to send multiple requests, so to speak, towards each other. Then for HTTP, you have a lot of overhead because each time you have to create a new HTTP request with all that use a new TCP socket and do all that stuff to maybe send some small data. And once you have this tunnel, you can easily, for almost no costs, you can send messages through. Either way, right? So it's a very efficient thing. So here is schematically what I was talking about. So we have a browser and a server again. There's a TCP socket, and we have a two-way connection. So WebSockets enable two-way messages. There's no connection limit. The server has mostly 50 connections. The browser has 6 HTTP requests at the same time. So that goes away because once you have the tunnel, you don't have any problems with the HTTP connection anymore. We have multiple data types, so not only text messages, but also binary messages are supported, for example. It works with an upgrade, and we have the WS protocol. And this is how the lifetime looks like. So we have the HTTP handshake, we exchange some data, and it could be that that connection is eventually closed, but it can also go on forever, right? So with the auction site just now, when an auction is over, you could imagine that a certain connection is closed. But that wouldn't be very efficient. It would be way more efficient for that server. I didn't check it with Vakantieveilingen, but to open up one tunnel and do all the auction data, put it all through the same tunnel, right? Then you don't have any overhead anymore for requests. So that was part two. Are you still with me? All right, good. We're at the end of the conference, so I'm just checking once in a while if you're still awake. All right, so SignalR. So SignalR is an open source framework, part of ASP.NET Core, right, which is also open source, of course. And it uses these low-level transports I was talking about, but it is on top of these transports. It kind of hides the complexity around these lower level transports. So this is schematically how it looks like. So SignalR is on top of these long polling or events, service end events or WebSocket transport. And one of the features of SignalR is that it can... Well, it's of course cross-platform, fast, and lightweight, just like ASP.NET Core. And it can be, you have, this slide. I want this slide. And it actually has a fallback mechanism. So we have these browsers and these servers that support certain low-level transports, but we don't really know. We don't really know when we initiate a request which one is going to work. Right? Is it WebSockets? Is it service end events? And SignalR offers an extra handshake to check if both server and client understand the same protocol. So by default, SignalR will first try a WebSocket connection. And if that doesn't work out, it will fall back to service end events. And if that doesn't work out, it will fall back to long polling. And that's just for free. When you use SignalR, you have that by default. You can, of course, configure differently to use one fixed transport, but by default, there's this fallback mechanism. It's just one of the features. Now, there are two parts in SignalR. So we have a NuGet, not a NuGet package, it's part of ASP.NET Core. We just have a library that ASP.NET Core uses on the server side. And we have a JavaScript library that you use on the client part. So we are somehow involved with JavaScript. If you don't like JavaScript at all, maybe SignalR is not the way to go, but you have to write a bit of JavaScript to do it. I will just show you in a minute. So SignalR works with a very, I would almost say, old-fashioned mechanism called remote procedure call. We use this since the beginning of computing, I think. Remote procedure call is just the calling of a function over the wire. So when a class has a function, or a method, or whatever you call it, that function has a name, and I can call it by name, and I have to supply some parameters, and I have to supply these parameters. And somehow I can do that over the wire. So I am on one side of the line, and the application is on the other side, on the server, and I can call that procedure remotely. So that's remote procedure call, and that is exactly what SignalR uses. So that's another layer that is on top of the simple transports. So we had this fallback mechanism, and this is another feature that is added to make things simpler and easier to understand for us developers. And it uses, so SignalR uses a hub. So a hub is a centralized part of your SignalR application. And a hub can send and receive messages from the client, and it can send messages to the client. Right? So that's just a class you derive from the hub base class. And then you can implement a hub. We'll show you that in a second. So here's how that works. So here we have just a normal ASP.NET Core application. And we have this hub implemented inside the application. And let's say there are three users, all using a browser. And let's say this is the auction site I showed you earlier. Then I do a bid. I send a message to the hub using this underlying transport, whatever it is. And SignalR, if it's WebSocket, it's easy. You can go to the WebSocket tunnel. And if it's server send events, we have this one-way communication between server and client. So in that case, SignalR will automatically use a normal HTTP request to do that. Automatically, you don't have to do anything for that. So the message arrives at the hub, and the hub reacts to that. And one of the reactions a hub could have is send all others a message that a bid was placed, right? You could also react differently to it. You're just free to do whatever you want with that message. But in the case of the auction application, it is to inform all others of the fact that a bidding was placed. So now we dive into the code. I have a simple SignalR app. I'm going to show you the server, the JavaScript client, and a .NET client, because that's also possible. So here we have Visual Studio. And I have this application. I will run it. called Wired Brain. And with Wired Brain, you can order a coffee. So you can, for example, order an Americano. I don't know the Czech version of coffee. But you can enter that as well. You can enter a size. It's very simple. It doesn't have drop downs or whatever, just string fields. And whenever I do submit, you can see somebody ordered an Americano, and we see some process going on that creates this Americano for me, and I'm informed about the status of it. Right? That's the application. So this is, I think this is Firefox. Yes, this is Firefox. So when I open this thing in, for example, Edge. No, not that one. So here, I have two browser instances now. So let me order, let me refresh this to be sure that it works. So now, oh, you can see a very responsive design here, right? So I'm good at responsive designs, obviously, but I've just used Bootstrap, so it's kind of automatic. Whenever I do the ordering again here, you can see that the other browser receives the message somebody ordered an Americano, but it doesn't receive the other messages if they are coming. Yeah, so now we're steaming milk, we're taking a sip, but the other one doesn't get these, only that somebody ordered an Americano. Just like this Amazon site that shows you, well, somebody ordered this article, right? So hurry up, we still have 10 left. I don't know. It's all fake, of course, but you could do that. Theoretically, you could do that. Okay. So let's see how this works. So first of all, I have one application. So this is just one normal ASP.NET Core application, nothing special. It has some HTML, and it has this coffee hub. I've created a folder for that, and you can call it whatever you want. I thought hubs was a logical name. So, and you can see that I have a hub in here that derives from the hub base class. And I inject something called an order checker, and that's my fake order simulator, of course. And I have this method called getUpdateForOrder. And so the thing is that every method that I'm implementing here that is public is callable by the browser. So the browser can call this method, supplying an order ID. And then something happens. I have a little loop here that checks if there's an update. It does some artificial waiting. Then it looks is there an update to show? Is there a new update? And if so, it calls a function on the client. So the hub can receive function calls from the client, and it can call functions on the client. It can do both. So here we have a client's property that is part of the hub object. And here we can select to which clients I want to send the message. So I can say caller. So caller, that's me ordering the Americano, right? It's only me, only the one ordering the coffee. But I can also say clients, all, for example, or all except. If you want to exclude somebody, maybe a colleague or, I don't know, who you don't like. or you can say, I want to send this thing to a certain group. And groups just have names. But for now, I'm using caller. So that's the reason only the calling, the initiating browser, saw these updates, and not the other browser, right? So only the caller gets it. You can see that I'm sending, as a parameter, the update object. And the update object is just a normal POCO. It's new, an update, which is a string, which has this steaming milk thing, etc. And a Boolean to indicate if it's finished or not. And that serialization and deserialization is taken care of automatically by SignalR as well. When I'm finished, then I send the caller the message, okay, I'm finished. And I can choose whatever I want in the client, what I do with that. I could, for example, say, I'm closing the connection. I'm done. So let's switch to the JavaScript. I just have a simple HTML page here, and so no MVC or whatever, just a simple HTML page. It looks like this. And it includes two JavaScript files. One is the SignalR library, which is, of course, installable with NPM or whatever you use. And I have my own JavaScript file. I've created that myself. So let's see what that looks like. So here I have a function called setupConnection. And it uses something of inside that SignalR library called the Hub Connection Builder. And I can just say, okay, this connection must go to this relative URL, and that's the URL where the hub is located. So let me switch back to the server for a bit and show you the startup class of this project. And what we see here is we see services add SignalR. Ignore this for a bit. Just say services add SignalR. And here it says app use SignalR to plug it into the pipeline. And this is your route. So we have a routing mechanism here. So just with it's the same with controllers. We have a routing mechanism that says, okay, this hub class has to listen to this relative URL, right? So now we have inserted a piece of middleware into the pipeline that listens to that relative URL and reacts to SignalR messages. So let's go back to the JavaScript again. And now you see that once I have this connection, so this is just an idle connection, right, that I created. This is a factory pattern, right? It just builds up a connection object. And now I can say, well, I want to react to certain function calls the server does. So when the server calls receive order update on me, then I get a parameter. This is the parameter that the server will send. That's the update object I told you about. And then I can just say what I want with that. So in this case, I'm pulling out a div, and I put the update in the inner HTML. There's also a new order function. I will show you how I call that in a bit. And that will say somebody ordered and then the coffee name. And finish stops the connection, right? And after I've done this configuring, I have to start the connection, and I can do some error handling. And all I do here is I call this function, and it sets up the whole connection. It starts the connection, and that's it. Okay, so let's run again. This time with one browser. Oh, it was Chrome, by the way. Let's see if it's still there. Yeah, it's still there. And now run it with the F12 tools. So when I refresh, you can see that here we have a WebSocket handshake. And it returns a 101. 101 means update is good. We're good to go. The server says we're good to go. So the upgrading has been completed. So that's cool. Let me zoom out a bit. So when I submit, you can see a fetch. Let's see. Oh yeah, so the connection has been established, and now I can go to frames. And with frames, I can see each WebSocket message is composed of frames. So when you do binary messaging, for example, you can get that the whole message can be transferred. You can, when you do streaming, for example, you have an audio file or whatever, you can chop that into frames, and each frame can be sent separately to the client. In this case, I have very small messages. So what I'm seeing here is each frame is just one message. So you can see there's a type there, there's new order with arguments, product, and size. So that's how the message is being transferred through that WebSocket pipeline. So let's switch to the controller now, because when I press this submit button, when we go look at the JavaScript, you can see that something happens when I click that button. And it basically just gets the data and it does a fetch. This is the new fetch API in JavaScript, which initiates an HTTP request. And it says, well, just post this data to the server. And this is posted to a normal controller. This is a normal HTTP request, right? And when that's done, I say connection invoke get update for order. And connection is, of course, the SignalR part. So let's see what the controller does. Now, I could, of course, to be clear, I could have done everything with SignalR if I wanted. That would be actually more efficient. But to show you what else is possible, I thought this was a good idea. Because we have a controller, and this controller can take an iHub context of Coffee Hub. So now I have this context of this hub, and I can use this hub inside a normal controller. So I have two options. I can do it via the hub or via the normal process. And whenever this post for a new coffee comes in, I say Coffee Hub clients all send async new order and then the order. And that's the message you saw, somebody ordered a blah, 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 right? The only downside of this is that I don't have the caller's context in the controller. So I can do all, but I cannot do caller. Caller doesn't exist on this object. There's no caller context. And you can also not do accept. You can do all accept, but you have to have specific client IDs. You can not say accept the caller or whatever. So just all. So this is a bit limited. But you can still do it. All right. So that's cool. Let me show you another way to create a client. Here, in this same solution, I have a console client. And this console client is also a SignalR client. So we don't have a browser now, we just have a .NET application. And when I start them both, then we hopefully we have a console application here. This is the web console application. And this is the client console application, and I can press a key to start listening. And when I now order an Americano, hopefully I get an exception. Oh yeah. That's because I commented out that message pack protocol. That was not too smart. Let's do it again. Start listening. Press the button. And there we go. Somebody ordered an Americano. So this is not a browser anymore. This is just a console application. So in this console application, you can just add a dependency to a NuGet package. And you can just add Signal R client. And if you do that, you can, this API looks very familiar now, because it's the same API the JavaScript library uses. I first build a connection, and then I do a strongly typed version of connection on, right? And I'm saying I'm expecting an order back, an order as a parameter. So this order is now of that type. And then I can react to that. So it's very nice that I kept the API more or less the same. And in ASP.NET Core 2.2, a Java client will be available as well. I don't know why you should use that, but okay. Sorry. Not supposed to say that out loud. The structure of the application. Now this message pack thing. So apart from, the default serialization and deserializing mechanism of SignalR is JSON. But there are some more efficient ways to do that, right? JSON is, it's more efficient than XML, but it's not the most efficient because it's still text, right? So if you want a binary a method to serialize and deserialize to, you can use message pack. It's just a binary format. And you can add this hub transport, it's called a hub transport, to your configuration. But you have to be, I showed you just now, you have to make sure it's supported by both sides. If one side doesn't support it, it doesn't work anymore. And a message pack protocol is provided by the team, by the Microsoft team. But there are other protocols that are being added by the community. Okay. So, differences with classic SignalR. So, the ASP.NET Core version of SignalR is simpler. And that's good news and bad news. Because the good news is it's simpler. You don't have to think as much, because as developers we're lazy, of course. So it's a very easy model. It's even that simple that when you create a SignalR application and you want to talk to that single SignalR application without having a client library yet, I don't know, Python maybe or whatever, then you could just use WebSockets and SignalR will pick that up. So it's really lying there on a low level, lower level than in classic SignalR. And there's a single hub per connection. So there's now when you create a connection, it's a connection for one hub. You cannot create a connection anymore for multiple hubs. And that's because there's no state on the server anymore. It's now a stateless system. So it's also more performant. Everything is async, client as well as a server. I told you about the protocols. There's no jQuery dependency, of course, anymore. But there is one thing, and that is sticky sessions. And that brings me to the final part of this presentation. I'm sorry, I have to leave you very soon in 11 minutes, 27 seconds. So, scaling out. What's the thing here? So when we have finished our nice SignalR application, we're going to deploy that to the cloud, right? Or to some on-premise server if you're still on-premise. I don't hope so, but could be. So we have a couple of problems then, because when I scale out, so in other words, I add more servers for my application. So in Azure, that's just a slider, right? You can select the number of instances of your application. Then I create multiple servers. So I have three servers now here. And my application runs on three servers. So now, when a client initiates a connection to one of the servers, and the server sends a message back, that will work without problems with WebSockets, because that's a tunnel. And once the tunnel is there, it sticks between the browser and the server. But if any other transport is used, like long polling or whatever, then the next request that comes in could end up at another server, right? And that server has no idea what happened before, because it's a different server, right? So to accommodate for that, we can use something called sticky sessions. And with a sticky session, we have there is a load balancer. This green thing is supposed to be a load balancer. I'm sorry. I'm not creative enough to do these kind of things. And this load balancer sets a cookie. So when the first request comes in, it sets a cookie in the browser and it says, well, server one, this is your server, server one. And the next time this cookie comes along, passes the load balancer, the cookie says, the load balancer says, oh, you have server one, I see that. Okay, you get server one. So that's sticky sessions. Okay. The other problem we have is, for example, when we have this Google Docs thing going on, or Office 365. I have to promote Microsoft. So Office 365, of course, no Google Docs. let's say you, sir, are creating a document, and you invite me to collaborate, right? And we work together at the same time on the document. So when you initiate document, then you're on a certain server. You're connected to a certain server with your sticky sessions or your WebSockets. You're at one server. But I could be on another server. And another person could be on the third server. So whenever I hear you do a change to the document, and you write code that says clients all, and then send a function, then all is only all for this server, all clients that are connected to this server, not to the others. So I won't get an update. So he's typing like hell here. He's already doing it, by the way. And I don't see anything. So there's a problem. So in order to do that, we can use a sort of a centralized storage kind of stores the client connections temporarily into some storage. And actually, there's out-of-the-box support for that in SignalR using a Redis cache. You can configure that in the configure services method, provided with a connection string, and you can use a Redis cache. And Redis cache is also available in Azure, or you can do it on-prem or whatever. Actually, it doesn't even store the data in the Redis cache. It uses a pub/sub mechanism, which is native for Redis, to inform the others of the fact that there's a new client. So now every server has an up-to-date list of connected clients. And that's really cool. So whenever you go to Azure, here's Azure, and this is an app service my application runs in. It's called WideBrain, widebrain.azurewebsites.net. And whenever you deploy your application, go to the properties. And when you go to the properties, there are a couple of things that are very interesting. Not the properties, the app settings, application settings. So, first of all, we have WebSockets here, a WebSocket setting. By default, this is off. So that's very interesting. You're deploying your SignalR application, and you never get, so you're debugging, you're looking at what's happening, and you always get server-side send events. because WebSockets is disabled on the server. So that's not very efficient. So you have to turn that on first. And the other one is RRR Affinity. That's the Microsoft translation of sticky sessions. It's just sticky sessions. This is default. This is on by default, by the way. But if you have a really funny colleague that has turned this off, it won't work anymore. So you have to be careful for that as well. So, final topic, 5 minutes left, is Azure SignalR. So, we have these scaling out problems, right? I talked about the number of connections. There's a limit to that. There's even a limit to the number of connections, the number of WebSockets you can build. I don't know exactly what it is, but there is some limit. We have the scaling out problems with the sticky sessions. You have to configure that and cater for that. And we have the Redis configuration that you have to do. So these are all kind of moving parts, right? So Microsoft wouldn't be Microsoft if there wasn't a server, an Azure service that you could just use to solve most of these problems. That's called Azure SignalR. So Azure SignalR solves these problems and the connection limit problem. And the connections are just scalable. So just like you add new instances for your web application, you can add new connections to your SignalR service. And of course, you pay for that. And when you do that, you can configure your application, and that's actually very easy to do, to offload all client connections to that SignalR service. So how does that work? I have a slide for that. So here we have the server. As soon as a client says, okay, I want to connect to your SignalR application, the server says, sends this message to the SignalR service. It says, okay, I have a new client connection for you. And that service maintains the actual connection to the client. Whenever the server wants to send a message to one or more clients, it just informs the Azure service, okay, you have to send this message, and it will take care of it. And now the other way around, if a client sends a message, then of course it goes the other way around. It's actually how it works. Well, the recipe for that is you just create a SignalR application, you create a SignalR service in the portal, and it will get you a connection string, and you use the connection string in the application. So, here I have this WiredBrain, sorry, not the app service. This is WiredBrain SignalR service. And this WiredBrain SignalR service has a certain number of units, unit count, and one unit has a certain number of the maximum number of connections. I can do it for free, then I have up to 20 connections. And if I pay 20 euros plus a month, I can have 1K of connections per unit and up to 100 units. So that's very easy to manage, to configure. So if you want to use that in your application, you just go to your startup class for your SignalR application, and instead of saying add use SignalR, you say app use Azure SignalR. And then you can provide a connection string that Azure gives you. Don't use this one anymore, of course, because then it will go wrong. And it will offload all these connections to SignalR. It's as easy as that. So, with that, thank you very much and have a great day.